I can't believe I am here with a spacecraft that is going to be rolling across the surface of Mars. It is so cool. Hi, I'm Emily Lakdawala, Solar System Specialist for the Planetary Society. And today I am in the clean room at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory where they're building the next Mars rover. I am so excited to be here. Come along. All right, so this is the Mars 2020 rover. This thing is going to be rolling across Mars. It looks quite a bit like the Curiosity rover, but there's a lot of differences between this rover and the previous rover. If you look up at the top of the rover's mast, you can see that it's got a whole lot of cameras up there. There's one big one that's covered with a red disc right now. That's the window for SuperCam. It's a laser-enabled instrument that will zap rocks and help the rover figure out what rocks are made of from a distance. If you look a little bit down from SuperCam, you can see there are four cameras below it. The ones with the red wings are called NavCams, and they're going to be used by the rover to help it navigate its landscape. And then the ones in the middle are the MastCams. Those are the science cameras that capture color images. Well, you can see on the front of the arm, there's a thing that looks kind of like a basket. That's going to contain the coring device, the device that's going to drill into the Martian surface and take rock samples and place them into hermetically sealed containers for a future mission to come pick up and bring those samples back to Earth. Below and to the right of that basket thing, you can see a little spherical thing. That will contain gas that the rover will actually be able to use to blow off the dust from the surface of whatever it's about to investigate. So it'll be wandering around Mars going and blowing off the dust. Tell me a little bit about some of the instruments and devices that we can see on the rover right here. Particularly interesting, I think, are all the stuff on the robotic arm. So can you tell me what we're looking at?
Yeah, so here in the front is the robotic arm kind of in a tucked pose. That robotic arm it can do a whole lot of science on the end of it, and it can reach and drill and take samples.
Can you also tell us about the HazCams?
Yeah, so the HazCams, which I'll go over and point to, they're kind of, I kind of think of them as like the front and rear camera, like the backup cameras for the for the rover. And they're the hazard avoidance cameras. So they're pointed at the ground to make sure that we're not going to be rolling over things that are going to damage the rover itself.
When we talk about this mission, most people just think of the rover, but there's actually several spacecraft involved in this. So this right here is the descent stage. This is a rocket-assisted jetpack that's going to help the rover descend all the way to the surface safely. The way this thing works is that it's all tucked up inside the aeroshell with the rover all folded up, crammed underneath its belly. There are some little rocket engines that will actually poke out of the top, the back of the aeroshell as it's descending, and help the whole thing spin back and forth in order to steer its way toward its landing site. Once it finally reaches the point where it wants to be, it'll hover. It'll descend slowly and come to a hover while the rover is coming down from this descent stage on three cables until the rover will gently touch the surface with its wheels. So the engineers like to call this a flying gas can because almost all of it is taken up by five huge tanks that carry all the fuel that it needs in order to provide all of the power to these huge engines that are on the bottom of the spacecraft. These red caps are covering the gigantic engines that can provide up to 700 pounds of thrust each as it brings the rover to a hover before it descends to the surface. These little black cylinders, they are gyroscopes. They are what helps the whole spacecraft figure out which way is up. They're very important. Without that, this thing will crash. The most prominent thing that you can see on this descent stage right now is the thing that's sticking out in front and seems to be looking down. Tell us what that is and what it's going to be used for.
Yeah, that's our landing radar. It gives us altitude and velocity in the final moments of entry, descent, and landing.
And I think you had fun testing this thing. How do you test the radar system?
The part of our team that does that, they get to fly around in helicopters and even in an F-18 in order to simulate the altitude and velocity characteristics that this radar will see.
And so with this radar instrument, it's going to be able to feed information to its computer. The computer will figure out where the rover is with respect to the hazards that are in its landing ellipse and will actually be able to avoid some of the hazardous terrain. And so that allows it to land in a trickier landing site than Curiosity was able to do, right inside a crater, right up against a river delta.
My name is Diana Trujillo, and I am the surface phase lead for SES in the robotic arm science area. What that actually means is actually the placement of the robotic arm and the two instruments that go on the turret, which is Pixel and Sherlock. It's actually our main goal to be able to place them on a specific target and understand if there is biosignature with these two instruments.
Now, biosignature is a really cool word. Can you tell me what that means and what it is you're looking for a little more specifically?
Right. So from my standpoint as an engineer, we get together with the scientists, and through the images, they will recognize or pick up which ones is the actual target that they're interested. Once we pick the actual target, my job is to make sure that we place them exactly where they want to be placed, that I have a way of wedging the turret into that target and taking those images that will help them see exactly what the composition is of that rock.
Can you tell me just how this particular rover is going to go about acquiring samples and storing them and dropping them?
This is the beauty and one of the differences, and one of the major differences from Curiosity. So with Curiosity, we were drilling a hole, and then we were capturing it to put it into SAM or Kemen when we were doing the doggy bag drop-offs. Now, with actually 2020, we're going to capture the sample, and as we're capturing the sample, the drill bit itself is actually a tube. It collects the sample on the tube, and then we go ahead and we dock with the bit carousel, drop that tube, and then take that tube and take images, and then go ahead and seal it for then later on another mission to come pick it up. So what I like about this mission is that I feel like I'm doing, you know, Apollo 11 on Mars right now, and you're hoping that you're going to bring that sample back and everybody's going to analyze it and recognize that there's something amazing that we haven't figured out before.
For the people who are watching this who want to do what you do for a living, how did you get here?
I'm actually born in Cali, Colombia. I came to the U.S. I didn't know any English, and then I decided I want to work for NASA one day. I went for aerospace engineering, and you know, I just did really well at school, and then hoped that things were going to work out for me. And I think that the major trait that I will say to the public is never giving up and not caring about what's happening, just what you think in your heart that works.
Thank you so much, and good luck on this mission.
Thank you so much.